He was in IBM for 27 years, but then he became a political activist, like most of us are, and he thinks particularly about history. And he's became a member of the United States History Standards Review Panel. Used to rewrite history standards for 11th grade. Is very familiar with the history standards in the Texas schools. Had a lot to say about what's going to be in there and how that they've been twisted. He's an expert on CSCOPE, and he's going to talk about that right now. And I think you'll find him a very good speaker with a lot of good information. So, Bill, would you like to come up here?
Indoctrinate our students with their own contempt for America's traditional values. And as the misinformed students become voters, it becomes easier to manipulate their discontent and ignorance of real United States history into acting as useful idiots for the support of socialist, anti-free enterprise agenda that the left wishes to use to dismantle America. Did you know that the underage of 30 voters now comprise about 30% of the electorate? And did you know that in 2012, over 60% of those voters voted for Obama? It is clear that they are being influenced by indoctrination in public schools. As Charlton Heston noted, the social studies culture war, part of a much larger culture war that is raging across our land. In my presentation today, I will discuss my involvement with history textbook review process during 2002, state-level history standards development in 2009 and 2010, the current issue of CSCOPE in some 875 public schools across the state of Texas, and the across-the-country threat posed by the federal curriculum Common Core. Further, there are issues surrounding U.S. history curriculum development in Texas large school districts, districts who do not use CSCOPE, but rather develop their own history curriculum. The main point to take away from this presentation, folks, is that the left never gives up. I will show you a number of examples how different elements of the education establishment try to hijack our history, and how in some cases they succeeded, and in some cases they failed. For those of you who have squeezed a balloon, you know that it pops out somewhere else, and that the left's ongoing effort to hijack history curriculum is like that. My book, Texas Trounces the Left's War on History, is a major step in my involvement in public education issues over 10 plus years. During 2009 and through May of 2010, the Texas State Board of Education had the responsibility to review and revise the 10-year-old social studies standards for the social studies curriculum, and that included United States history. The 15 elected State Board of Education members have no staff, therefore they do not have the resources to create the detailed proposals that recommend the content for what social studies courses should look like. For this reason, groups of volunteers, called review panels, were appointed early in 2009. I was a member of the United States History Review Panel, along with 8 others. I was the only conservative. I was the only non-educator on my review panel. The other 8 were all teachers or education administrators, and they varied politically from left of center, all the way to having contempt for America. I've been an education activist since 2001. Most of my work has been associated with United States history issues. The course is taught to 11th grade students in Texas public schools. In 2002, I was a volunteer reviewer of a McGraw-Hill United States history textbook as part of the State Board of Education's textbook review process. My review of the book was page by page, line by line. I documented some 200 concerns that I had with the book's content. As a result of my work, State Board of Education member Tynesy Miller arranged for me to meet with McGraw-Hill representatives. Spent 2 long days with about 5 senior editors from McGraw-Hill in a conference room in the Park City's Hilton Hotel and Dallas. Interesting experience. Tapping the senior editor on the shoulder and saying, Mr. Senior Editor, please help me understand why the Wright brothers' first powered flight is not in your textbook. There are many examples of how leftist writers create a negative view of history in a textbook. Time here limits me to one example, the invasion of Omaha Beach on D-Day, June 6, 1944. This example, however, perfectly represents the subtle negativity that textbook writers inject into the textbook. In the proposed textbook version, submitted by McGraw-Hill to the State Board for approval, the page title for the D-Day invasion was called Nightmare at Omaha. A writer's quote from the page read, but in Omaha Beach, the landing threatened to turn into what General Bradley feared was an irreversible catastrophe. Winds and currents pushed the landing craft into clumps as men moved ashore. Soldiers ran onto the beach in groups and became easy targets. About 3,000 died on Omaha Beach. After my negotiation, the State Board of Education accepted version of the page I just showed you reads, A Day for Heroes. And this time, the quote reads, the bravery and determination of the infantry was tested in one of the fiercest battles of the war. And finally, Americans took control of the beach and fought their way inland. General Bradley later wrote, every man who set foot on Omaha Beach that day was a hero. This is a perfect example, folks, of how the same story can be told from the left's negativity or from a positive, pro-American perspective. All told, McGraw-Hill agreed to make about 100 changes to that textbook, making it more positive, more patriotic, and more pro-American. And while I was somewhat pleased, with the results, I had affected only one book of some 200 that were in the textbook approval cycle back in 2002. So the answer was to affect the social studies standards cycle, since standards drive all textbook content. I would have to wait for the standards review in 2009. So let's fast forward to 2009. During the review panel meetings in that year, I was outvoted 8-1 on nearly every issue. And when we completed our proposal to the State Board in October of 2009, we had created, in my view, an unacceptable document, which was an overly negative view of United States history. Sensing a need and being familiar with the review panel document, I was able to create over 50 amendments to balance the negativity of the proposal. And on December 3 of 2009, I presented my amendments package to Don McElroy. Dr. McElroy at that time was the chairman of the State Board of Education. Dr. McElroy accepted the amendments. Most were ultimately presented in the 2010 State Board meetings, and many were adopted by the State Board of Education. My book is dedicated to Mrs. Miller and Dr. McElroy. Without their work and without their support, 11th grade students in Texas would not have a course that teaches them a conservative, patriotic view of America. As an aside, this example points out how important it is for an activist to establish positive relationships with the key influencers in the process. I have previously established a relationship of trust with both Dr. McElroy and Mrs. Miller, so they listen. My book is also dedicated to my wife and best friend, Lynette, who's hiding over there behind the screen. Not only for her 70-plus heads-down hours in creating the cover illustration that you see in the room blown up into the bin, but mostly for her ability to successfully balance the nearly impossible roles of being both critic and cheerleader while I was writing this book. What is this story about? There are two competing approaches to teaching United States history in our public schools. The left attempts to indoctrinate our students that there is no social justice, that opportunities for all do not exist, that we are all victims, and that increased dependency on a socialist, Marxist government is the preferred solution that will bring equality of outcomes for all. The inclination by the left is to marginalize opportunity and penalize individual success. And this has been immortalized by President Obama's favorite comment, "You didn't build this." By contrast, mainstream Texans believe that America's good far outweighs her bad, and that our founding principles, our Judeo-Christian heritage, our strong roots in Western civilization, our work ethic, and our free market economy are the basis for 200 plus years of America's greatness and leadership in the world. This book is about the inevitable conflict between the two approaches and how it played out over the 1.5-year project to develop the social studies standards. And also it talks about the bizarre tactics that the left used to get its version of United States history into the standards. Let's look at a couple examples of those negotiations. Celebrate Freedom Week is a program implemented by the Texas legislature, and it's observed during the fall semester. Its purpose is to educate students about the sacrifices for freedom made during the founding of our country, and about the Christian-based values upon which our country was founded. Celebrate Freedom Week includes the study of the intent, the meaning, and the importance of the Declaration of Independence, the United States Constitution, and the Bill of Rights. During Celebrate Freedom Week, students in grades 3 through 12 are required to study the following text from the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The leftist educators on my review panel refused to include the Celebrate Freedom principles as part of the United States history standards by a vote of 8-1. Julian Aboa, an assistant professor of history at the University of Texas, El Paso, and a member of my review panel, disagreed further. In his testimony before the State Board of Education, Aboa objected to students reciting passages from the Declaration of Independence, saying that it, quote, violates the very concept of freedom that educators are attempting to uphold. Only later, in 2010, did the State Board of Education include the Celebrate Freedom Week Amendment in the history standards. Let's look at a second example. The concept of American exceptionalism was first documented by Alexis de Tocqueville in his 1830s book, Democracy in America. The United States is an exceptional nation. Most Americans would not regard that as a controversial statement, and with good reason. It is true. We are the only country in the history of the world that was founded on the principle that liberty and freedom trump government. But my attempts to include the concept of American history or American exceptionalism in the United States history standards were rejected by my review panel by an 8-1 vote. The opposition was ruthless. Again, a member of my review panel offered public testimony to a State Board of Education meeting. This time he contended that the concept of American exceptionalism is just an example of conservative wishful thinking, a bogus myth, and a false, idolatrous image of what America really is. Only later was the American Exceptionalism Amendment included and adopted by the State Board of Education. In his endorsement of my book, Wall Builders President and Constitutional Historian David Barnes wrote, "The inclusion of the Celebrate Freedom Week principles in the standards reflects the proper emphasis on the founding documents. And teaching American exceptionalism places history in an overall positive context. All told," wrote David Barton, "these are the best social studies standards since before World War II. There are numerous examples in the book of the adult supervision that the State Board of Education exercised to add or amend the review panel's flawed proposal. Some of the additional amendments adopted by the State Board of Education, one was having students actually read the wording of the First Amendment, the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause, and compare them to the popular term separation of church and state. We added the unintended consequences of the alleged benefits of the Great Society programs, fatherless families, paying single mothers to have additional babies out of wedlock, the destruction of the incentive to work, the destruction of inner city families, and the corresponding increases in poverty and crime. We reinserted key items to the standard that had been reviewed, that had been removed by the review panels. Veterans Day, Independence Day, the Liberty Bell, Christmas, Rosh Hashanah. We added the threat to United States sovereignty posed by global governments organizations like the International Court and the United Nations. We rejected the left's insistence to use the term U.S. imperialism rather than expansionism associated with our country's acquisition strategy. We taught, in fact, that communists had infiltrated our government during the 1930s, 1940s. And finally, we gave the free enterprise system, rather than government, credit as the primary driver of American technological innovation. Now, during all of this, my partners in the review panel didn't think a lot of that. They thought that their proposal was being hijacked. And one of the things I'm most proud of is that on May 10th of 2010, they testified and they read a letter that they had penned for their public testimony before the State Board. And part of the letter said, "Our committee work, however, was hampered by day one from Bill Ames. For example, Mr. Ames wanted to add a brand new standard based solely on patriotism," how about that, "that included school-wide participation, and celebrate Freedom Week. Good. I'm reminded of Andrew Breitbart's favorite quote. He said, "If you're not drawing enemy fire, you're not over the target." Let me summarize to this point. In 2010, conservatives influenced the culture of Texas public schools. Temporarily, we trounced the left's war on history. But like that squeezed balloon I showed you earlier, the left has reinitiated the culture war on social studies and United States history in Texas. Parents and citizens in Texas have recognized the new threat. It is called CSCOPE. CSCOPE was initiated by a group of superintendents in 2006. Because of the cost savings to small school districts, the CSCOPE curriculum has been widely accepted, and CSCOPE is currently used in some 875 of Texas' over 1,200 school districts. And because parents have been denied access and teachers were forced to sign non-disclosure agreements regarding CSCOPE, the content of CSCOPE lessons has been shielded from parents, citizens, the public, and even the State Board of Education. And due to the extreme secrecy, the CSCOPE agenda has only begun to leak out during the past year. My friend activist Alice Linehan has compiled a list of the most anti-American, anti-Christian, egregious lesson plans included in the CSCOPE curriculum. Time does not permit me to discuss each of these individually. Rather, the intent is to show you the tone of the CSCOPE lesson plans and how they violate American and Christian values. Each of these 10 items is explained in great detail in Mrs. Linehan's website, voicesinpower.com. Voicesinpower.com. They include mischaracterization of the rights of Muslim women, the description of Christianity as a cult. There's a ladder, and they show an individual climbing from the bottom, which is capitalism, to the top, which is communism. The kids were asked to design a flag for a new socialist country. Christopher Columbus was no longer thanking God for a successful voyage, but rather he was a supporter of environmentalist goals. Paul Revere, the pot-peddling patriot, and the Boston Tea Party was a terrorist attack. Students were asked to join a United Nations roundtable on population control. There was a student exercise to chart a pilgrimage to Mecca. And finally, the Black Panthers were lauded as valid civil rights activists. Now, the citizen outrage from these and other CSCOPE lesson plans was so intense that Senator Dan Patrick, chairman of the Senate Education Committee, conducted a hearing on January 31st, 2013. The committee literally took CSCOPE representatives to the woodshed. Typical was Senator Patrick's comment, "If you guys were an airline, we would ground you." On March 7th, Senators Patrick and Donna Campbell filed Senate Bill 1406. Please write that down, 1406. This bill gives the State Board of Education oversight of all curriculum activity carried out by the regional service centers in the Texas Education Agency. Senate Bill 1406 was passed 30 votes to zero by the Texas Senate. And moving on to the House, it was passed out of committee on April 30th. Hopefully, CSCOPE administrators will be put on a short leash thanks to the Texas education activists. another dimension to U.S. history curriculum development in Texas. 20 to 30% of Texas school districts do not use CSCOPE, since they are large enough to have their own resources to develop their own curriculum. Their combined student population may well exceed that of the CSCOPE school districts. The key concern is there is no state level oversight or supervision of any school district's curriculum development process. In September of 2011, I began a review of the Richardson ISD 11th grade history curriculum. That's the school district in which I live. And I was disappointed to find that it was significantly out of compliance with the state U.S. history standards. Contrary to the state board standards, the Richardson ISD defined the United States as an imperialistic country. The Richardson curriculum ignored the requirement to teach American exceptionalism. And rather than balancing between environmental regulations and Fifth Amendment property rights, the Richardson ISD curriculum simply had a lesson plan entitled Saving the Earth. There were many others. But I believe that the Richardson situation is not an isolated incident. Given the absence of oversight, large district curriculum simply becomes a function of the ideology of the curriculum developers. Texas Education Code clearly requires local school district compliance with the state board standards as a condition of their accreditation. Further, many critics view CSCOPE as an ideological little brother to Obama's National Common Core curriculum. Texas cannot allow leftists to substitute its anti-American, anti-Christian agenda in opposition to the state board standards victory that wall builders Rick Green has said, this is the most important victory in the culture war that I, Rick Green, have seen in my lifetime. But you know, without adult supervision over curriculum development, this victory will become meaningless. In one of the closing chapters of my book, I wrote, the Texas social studies battle has been won temporarily, but the left's war on education is far from over. In most states across the country, the left's war on education continues. The offending curriculum is called Common Core. Now, what is Common Core? Common Core is a national, one-size-fits-all, national curriculum for public schools. It is promoted and funded by special interests and the federal government. It involves the loss of local control, because local curriculum developers no longer have any say. Frequent tests are conducted by outside vendors hired by the federal government, and student scores on those assessments and tests are 50% of the teacher's evaluation. Any material taught in the school district in addition to Common Core may not exceed 15% of class time. And there is an intrusive Common Core student database called P20 that tracks some 350 data points for each and every student in every public school. And that database is not only available to the Department of Education personnel, but also the Department of Labor, Corrections, Health, and Human Services. Now, let's talk a little bit about curriculum. This is the kind of slide that you should never use when you prepare a presentation. But what we have here is down the left is some of the elements that are taught in an education environment. In the middle are how those elements are handled in a traditional classic education mode, and on the right, how Common Core and CSCOPE handles those elements. And let's just look at a couple of them here. Anybody who wants this chart, we have a few copies over on the desk that you can pick up after the meeting. Hopefully not enough for your interest, but they're there anyway. Under curriculum, classical education teaches academics, it's fact-based. But Common Core is more based on social. The kids actually help determine what the learning process is and what they will learn. The teacher is no longer the authority, but just a facilitator in the curriculum approach. In English, phonics-based is the traditional method. Whole language is the Common Core approach. In social studies, the focus on American heritage, exceptionalism, national sovereignty, the founding documents. But in Common Core, the focus is on diversity, multiculturalism, globalization, revisionist history, and political correctness. Character development, traditional education, pro-faith, self-control, personal responsibility, self-discipline, and a work ethic. In Common Core, the focus is on secular education, moral relativism, anti-faith, and everybody is a victim. Equality, equal opportunity versus equal outcomes. So what can I do? Normally in a presentation such as this, the speaker urges members of the audience to get involved. While many understand what must be done, there are perhaps others who want to act but don't know quite what to do. I have an assignment for you. If any of this has resonated for you, with you folks, I would ask you to do one thing today. Senate Bill 1406 is stuck in the House Calendars Committee. And I would ask you to go home this afternoon or this evening, look up the names and phone numbers of the people who are on that calendars committee in the Texas House, pick at least one, and call and say, let's get Senate Bill 1406 out of calendars committee so it can go to the floor and get voted on. Will you do that? Yeah. Thank you. That will be a great help in what's going on today relative to this whole public education issue in Texas. Further, many of you are, and others aren't, involved in your school district. What are your kids being taught? What are your kids being taught? Have you met with a member of the school board? Have you met with a teacher? Have you met with the principal? Have you met with the superintendent? Okay, let's review. We've talked about how individual activism can influence a major area. That area is how United States history is taught in our public school. Doesn't take anybody special to do this. Anyone with a passion, a desire, willing to focus and stay with it over the long term can do this. In a few minutes, I'll be over there signing some books. But before I close, let's look briefly at what history should look like. During my work on the history standards, I got to know Dr. Larry Schweikart. Dr. Schweikart is a history professor at the University of Dayton, and you may have heard of him because he co-authored the New York Times bestseller called A Patriot's History of America. And his documentary, folks, is what history should look like. Watch this 4-minute documentary trailer carefully. It will send chills up your spine, and it will give you that pride in America feeling that needs to be infused in our Texas students. The greatest adventure upon which man has embarked. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. God has blessed us with a great country. The Texas History Standard will hopefully teach our students that this country is worth preserving. I've been truly blessed to be able to make a difference in United States history education in Texas. My journey has been a real adventure. And thank you for inviting me to talk to you folks today to tell my story about patriotic and Christian activism and education. I have a few minutes for comments and questions.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, I think it's on now. Okay, for those of you that have questions, as we know, we put them on cards. If you'll put them on some cards, and then my wife and Biff will be getting the cards from you, and then Ernie will take them and we'll answer the questions. I just want to thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And I want to talk this book. He's here and selling the book and signing it. It's an excellent thing to have. It's an excellent resource, because it tells you one story about history, but you learn a lot about how the left works. As he said, it's just one small victory. We have, they're insidious, and they'll keep coming. So I urge you to talk to them afterwards. If your question wasn't asked, or you think the question, talk to him and go get a book over here and have him sign it. Are there any more questions, Biff, if you want to give it? Because this is a never-ending battle for the culture right now, and we're losing it, but we have to keep fighting. And I think Bill showed you what one man can do, and you know, sacrifices by all of us, and I know we all get tired of doing it. Oh, it's that again, you know, I've tried that so many times, it doesn't work, but we've got to keep fighting. Okay, Ernie?
What is the probability of banning CSCOPE in Texas?
Of killing it? My guess is that CSCOPE will not be killed, unfortunately. My guess is that if this 1406 bill passes after you call your calendars committee this afternoon, I think it will be suppressed. I think there will be control over curriculum development, and it won't be perfect, but it certainly will be a step in the right direction. And it will be a chastisement if, you know, not any more than people getting their hands slapped. There should be legal action against these people, because they have done a lot more than polluted our curriculum. They have set up an illegal, tax-free organization within the education establishment, whereby they use Texas education resources funded by you taxpayers to develop all of these lesson plans. Then they turned around and sold that product to the school districts for about $7 a head per year to the kids. Nobody knows where that money goes. Nobody knows. So, you know, they developed this CSCOPE thing at your expense. They are selling it to the school districts at your expense. The Attorney General is involved in that and is very concerned about it. And one of the, let me take a little bit of a side trip here and talk about local control. Local control is something people always talk about. Local control of my school district, right? What is local control? My definition of local control is that parents and citizens in the community, like you folks, decide what the policy of your local school district ought to be, and you implement that policy through your elected board of trustees. Now in CSCOPE, citizens and parents have surfaced all of these bad lesson plans to the point where the legislature is involved. But we are seeing, one of the most discouraging things to me is we are seeing across the state, local superintendents are rising as one voice in defense of CSCOPE. And not only defending CSCOPE, but actually ridiculing the CSCOPE critics who are surfacing these lesson plans. So I would propose to you that a superintendent's view of local control is that I, the superintendent, have total authority as what your kids are going to be taught in my school district, and you have no say. So CSCOPE is just a symptom of this shift, and local control in the classic sense is being controlled by the community is all but dead in Texas.
How many printed pages are there in a one-day CSCOPE lesson that teaches you?
May I ask you the question? I have a little hearing problem. Okay.
How many printed pages are there in a one-day CSCOPE lesson plan that the teachers use each day in class?
How many printed pages are there in a lesson plan each day?
I have no idea.
Okay.
I have no idea.
Are you familiar with the cloud documents that keep track of the entire revision history of any document? If so, would this be helpful in identifying those who want to?
Who want to change our history in our textbook. Again, I really haven't studied the cloud stuff. I know that it's emerging, and so I really don't have an answer to that question either.
Since the first nine states voluntarily voted to join the union between the states and all future states,
were admitted
on an
equal basis, do you believe the states have a right to voluntarily secede from the union? See? I know that Texas joined the United States as a republic, and I think that one of the deals Texas struck was the ability, if it chose to break into something like, what, nine states?
Nine.
Yeah, nine. And do you think we'll do that? I don't know.
True.
I don't know.
No, secede, not break into five, become our own republic again.
I can see that if the current direction of our government towards socialism and Marxism continues and gets much worse, I could see some of the southern states saying, we're out of here. I really could see that. I think that would be an extreme move. It might be good for the states to do that. But, there will be a lot of opposition to that, too. Yes, ma'am.
One thing that I can see on that line is that the United States going toward Nazism is seceding from the Constitution. So what we would be the true United States that would be left.
Right.
And they would be the fake United States that would be still remaining, and we would still be here. But a history point I'm not clear on is after the Civil War, war between states, what was Texas's status? Did it change from what it was when we went in as a republic? Did that delete our privileges we had as a republic of joining the United States? Or was there a change there in the law?
The question is, after the Civil War, did Texas' agreement to be able to split into nine states change? And again, I don't know the answer to that. Okay.
What type of questions are asked on the Texas test? Do they swing left or too conservative?
I think that the tests that are asked are definitely over on the left side of neutral. There was a question that one of the choices on a multiple choice test was there a possibility that Paul Revere was harboring illegal drugs in his home? With the Boston Tea Party, do you think they might have been terrorists? There were a number of questions like that that were surfaced by the parent and citizen community. And you know, so I think that the tests, as well as the lesson plans, are tainted towards the left. I think that there is a large group of folks in the education establishment who would like to implement their agenda. There are good teachers out there. There are teachers who are patriotic, who teach American principles, and they do a good job. But I think that they have been overwhelmed by different groups. I talked about textbooks. They are the college professors that have been contracted to write textbooks. And they write textbooks how Omaha Beach was a catastrophe. There were people on my review committee that literally had contempt for America. When we were talking one time about achieving the American dream, and we had put in folks like Sam Walt, we had put in folks, Estee Lauder. My proposal had to be multicultural, so Estee Lauder was in there. One of the persons on my review panel, in order to demean the whole notion of achieving the American dream, wanted to add investments when were Bernie Madoff to the list as someone who had achieved his version of the American dream. So we saw it on the review panel. Now we're seeing it in a bunch of regional service centers, people who live and work in the 20 regional service centers around Texas, who are, again, polluting history. Now these are, and then the Common Core folks, these are all part of a single movement, just implementing its desires in different ways. Yes, there is a negative tone to test, to lesson plans, and, you know, if you look at the work that your kids and grandkids bring home, you can find it. Last night, we presented to the Coppell Republicans, and a gentleman stood up and gave us a 10-minute talk about his experience in the Coppell School District dealing with principals and teachers because of what they were teaching his kid in a U.S. history course.
Thank you. Where can I find a printout of the Common Core?
I have worked closely with the people in Minnesota who are fighting the Common Core because that's where I grew up and I know some of the folks up there. And I have a lot of documentation of Common Core. There is another group that I've been working with since we went up to College of the Ozarks. If you Google Common Core Missouri, you will find a whole website of what they are doing to fight it, and I am sure that you will find links to the actual Common Core curriculum as well in you know, Googling Common Core Minnesota, Common Core Missouri, and you can find it that way.
Okay, thank you.
All right.